My name is Art Jones, and I am the director of Drink Factory, but I'm also the host for this screening this afternoon. You probably didn't see me at the beginning, if you were here at the very start of the film, because I got caught in traffic coming here. But that said, I am here, and I hope that you all enjoyed the filming. Can we give the actual filmmaker another round of applause? Without any further ado, what I want to do is introduce the actual director, the wonderful, dynamic, and engaging Margaret Byrne.
Oh, thank you.
And because we have a very limited amount of time, I was told I got 15 minutes to talk about this film, and there's a lot I would like to address. I want to say and give also people here the opportunity to connect with the director as well. So I want to start out with some very basic questions with regards to the project itself. How do you find Bertie, how did you find Bertie, North Carolina?
Yeah, so at the time I was living in New York, and I, it was actually just a small job to film at the alternative school, The Hive, and when I saw what was going on there, and when I, you know, was introduced to Vivian and these young men, I realized that there was a much bigger story here. And actually at the time I was working on a film called American Promise, which is a 13-year film that follows the education of two African-American boys, middle class, from Brooklyn, their entire education from kindergarten until they go to college. So I was working on that story, and when I came to Bertie County, I saw that there was a much different story happening there that wasn't being told.
How did you come to select the three young men that you highlight in the film?
I think, selecting who you choose to follow, we were originally following four guys, and then dropped down to two, and then I found Day-Day about 9 months later, because I really connected with his mom, Esther, and I think part of it was, I think they represented a cross-section of the young people in Bertie, particularly the young men. A lot of people ask, well, why didn't you follow any girls? And it's really just because we started at this alternative school for boys, so.
Well, speaking of on that very issue with regard to the boys, and there was a note that came up in terms of a card that within a 100-mile radius, there's like 27 prisons. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, so I think I looked into that statistic maybe 5 years into making the film, and we were working on the post-production, and I just was like, you know, I'd visited so many prisons. They're not all in this film. You know, you film a lot of things that get cut, but, and then driving through North Carolina, you see so many prisons. Bertie just expanded their prison. Neighboring county, Hertford County, has a private prison that's built on the largest slave plantation in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. And so all of that was sort of overwhelming. And I saw that it overwhelmed their lives too. It was a fear of theirs, all of them. And so one day I just counted how many prisons are within a 100-mile radius. There were 27. And that does not include jails. I'm talking about prisons. So, and then you see that in these young men's lives that they have somebody important to them in prison.
Speaking of someone being important in their lives, I thought it was really interesting that the lady who, Ms. Saunders, who put together The Hive initially, was put in a position where she had to close it down, and that was because, according to the gentleman from the school board, he said that it was more cost effective to just mainstream these students back into the normal population of a normal school without taking into account that there was something that she was providing for them at The Hive that they were not getting at the normal school system. Did you ever have any conversation with the superintendent as to why he made that crucial decision?
Yeah, Dr. Crawford was actually an interim superintendent, so they've had about seven superintendents since I have been in Bertie County. So their turnover rate is very high. And so he was an interim superintendent. His job was to balance the budget, because at the time the state was threatening to take over the school system. because they had no money in their fund balance. And so for him, he was just trying to fix a system that they couldn't afford. And so he felt like, well, whatever this organization, there was a nonprofit that was chartered out to run the Hive, which is what Vivian worked for. And they said, well, why are we paying them? We can do it ourselves. And really what happened is those young men, either they returned to the high school into the regular their regular classes, or they didn't return at all. And most of them did not.
But you saw a qualitative difference in terms of what she provided for them beyond the normal academic curriculum that was clearly absent when they went back into the school system. And that was a sense of concern, a sense of caring, a sense of our connection with these kids on a human level that was abundantly absent when the there's a scene with the young man who is, has an Asian teacher, who is extremely phlegmatic in terms of her interaction with him. When you look at it in contrast to this African-American woman who ran the Hive.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what Vivian provided was so much more than what the high school was providing. They were also in school until 6 p.m., so when they got off the bus at home, it wasn't, you know, it was 7 p.m., 8 o'clock at night, time to go to bed. They fed them breakfast, lunch, and dinner. A lot of these kids, they don't get dinner at home, you know. And I think that it, you know, it was really a loss, but Vivian was able to rebuild her center. They actually had a an electrical fire which shut down the building, and she received a very large operational grant from Kate B. Reynolds Foundation to rebuild her center, which is great.
Last question for me, because I know the audience has some questions that they want to ask. What did you want to have as the ultimate takeaway from creating a film like this in terms of its impact on the audience that sees it?
I think when I first met these guys, I saw that nobody really cared about them. And this was definitely obviously a marginalized rural population that nobody was really paying attention to. And I think now with, you know, our current political situation with the Trump administration, everybody's going, oh, well, what does rural America think? And rural America is actually incredibly diverse, and you know, their voices are important, as we can see, and they're powerful.
That said, let me open this up to other people.
Statistic about prisons is very important because it shows the two sides of the coin. The authorities at the state level, federal level, every level, prefer to invest in prisons instead of education, quality education, and real opportunities for people to develop. So that, I think it was very important that you included that statistic. But my question is, how did you manage to continue getting support to make the documentary throughout all these years, 6 years, 7 years? How did you get people to believe in the project?
I didn't.
Okay.
I didn't. I mean, it took me, I didn't receive any support for the first 4 years making this film. And it meant a lot to me. I think, you know, my family kind of looked at me like I was crazy. Why are you putting yourself in debt? I'm a single mother. I'm raising my child on my own. I'm asking favors of people so that I can make this happen. And, you know, there's times where I never thought that I wouldn't be able to put this story into the world because I knew that it was important enough. And I think it's a blessing that it came out at the time that it did, because I think more than ever we need to understand these communities that have never had a voice. I mean, in national education, nobody ever talks about rural education. And it's not just African-American. It's white, it's brown, it's all rural communities are struggling. And we don't ever hear from them.
It was a fantastic documentary, so thank you for, you know, sharing. So I wanted to know, are you still following any of these characters in your movie? And if you are, is there any plans to do any sort of follow-up to this film?
They are like family to me. So I, you know, we keep in touch. I see them. I'm still going there several times a year. Kiki, the little boy in the movie, he stays with us in the summer, so he's like a brother to my daughter. So she's looking forward to seeing him. And I don't have any plans to continue to follow them. I just, you know, I plan to continue to be in their lives. I don't know that I have a choice. I mean, they're always calling me, and you know, I mean, they're my family. And Esther's very much like my second mother, and has in some ways helped raise my daughter because she spent so much time there. So it's been a really unique experience in that sense that we did get that close.
So this is almost a follow-on question. One, thank you. I love the film. There are so many moments in it that are disheartening and heartwarming and nostalgic and beautiful and sad. You run through the range of emotions. What I'm curious about as you look at those subjects, and now they're family for you, how did you decide when you were going to end the film?
We were editing for about 18 months, and so I've been editing for at least a year before I finished shooting. And so I kind of knew the story arcs that I wanted to work with. And I think we were all just sort of like, to me, this film is really about opportunity youth, which is youth that are not in school, they're not in work, but they are an asset, you know. The people of Bertie are a huge asset that is underutilized because there is no opportunity there. So I think once they all sort of settled into like starting to raise families and kids and getting jobs, that I knew that that was sort of where I wanted to end it. And it was nice to go to Bertie and just not have a camera anymore, you know.
Over here.
I really appreciated that you kind of let their voice speak for the film itself. You didn't really put too much in, like, of your own opinions into it. I think my question is, what was the single most memorable or powerful moment for you?
It's a tough question. I mean, I think the whole experience, and it continues to be an experience that these are people in my life right now that I care about and I love and I'm rooting for, and it's very much influenced my daughter's life. I don't know, I mean, sometimes when I get frustrated at home, I live in Chicago now, I just want to go to Bertie and go stay at Esther's. Yeah.
Okay, we have another question here.
You said that you didn't get any support while doing this film. What gave you the inspiration to keep going?
I mean, I've never been afraid to take risks. At one point before, well, in the beginning of making this film, I was trying to build a housing business in Nigeria. So that didn't work out. The film did. It's not something I'm profiting off of, which I'm okay with. I truly believe that their stories were important, and I guess I cared about them enough where there's no way I could leave them. Even at this point, I can't ever leave them, you know.
Question, last one.
Yes. Well, the love that you have for this community, these individuals, clearly came through, and I was very moved. So thank you for making it. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about what drew you to doing this kind of long-term documentary work, because it's not your only one, and one that's even longer, it sounds like. So if you could just talk a little bit about what inspired you to do this kind of work, and how you managed it to keep that going.
I mean, I think longitudinal filmmaking, to me, is some of the most interesting work out there. The 7-Up series was definitely an inspiration for American Promise, and American Promise, you know, that experience taught me that, yes, I can do this. And I think as tools have become more available and you know, you can take a camera and go make a movie. I think, you know, I mean, it's why there's so many female directors in documentary, because you don't have to have somebody open a door for you. You could say, no, I've decided I'm making this story, and I don't need this gatekeeper to tell me that this is a worthwhile story. And the truth is that this film would never have been made commercially, because nobody really cares enough, especially not to spend this amount of time with people. And I've quit jobs working on commercial productions for that very reason, because they have no integrity, they don't care about the people they're filming, and they're looking for a story that will be sensational and sell, you know, commercials. So that's why I think documentary is more important than ever, especially right now.
So. I have one last question I want to ask with the arch of this, right? And that is, in the world of film, and this is someone said to me in my early days as a filmmaker, there are three elements that make for an effective film. One is it has to entertain, two it has to inform, and three it should inspire. Where along the spectrum would you say your film falls?
Well, there was an academic recently who wrote, he screened the film and he wrote an email, and his email was very blunt, and it said, I don't like the film. And I said, okay. And honestly, there's been, of course people don't like the film, they like the film, they don't like the film, they get it, they don't get it, they go, well, you're a white woman from the city, why are you making a film about black boys in the country? And he is an academic that is trying to put African-American males in positions of, to be teachers and principals, right? Yeah. To put them on that path. And so he wants documentaries that are about hope, that are about, you know, the basketball player that exceeds, that are about the chess player that exceeds all expectations. But those are stories of exception. And this is a story of what is really happening. And although it's a hard story to watch, and it was a hard story to tell, and it breaks my heart still, it's important because you can't get to that next step until you see and get this. And I think some people take advantage of the fact that they already get that, but not everybody does. And I would bet that not everybody in this room knew this story. And so I think that's why I made the film.
For those who are not with this, or not with us here, but may be able to access it at a future time, what's the plans for distribution?
So we will be on PVS. It's not officially announced, although POV was on the header of this, so I guess I'll just say it'll be on POV in August for back to school season. We have a theatrical planned, which is pretty exciting. I want to bring the guys out for that. And then it'll be available on digital in June, so anywhere you could access, and we'll be there.
Thank you very much. And thank you all for coming back. Thank you.